Yeah, that very day, So
today, the main disciples for this teaching are the Chinese from Singapore and others, and also from Hong Kong. So there are a few people from Hong Kong, and then from Malaysia also. So these are the main students for this discourse. Amongst them, there are many who are Buddhists, and there are also quite a few number of Christians. And there are also some who do not have any particular belief in any faith. So we are gathered here, all the Dharma brothers and sisters. So
South America,
Singaporeans mostly speak English, of course. So they do understand English. But then it seems there are some from South America. Although my English is not that good and I have not been able to improve much. And even if I may improve my English, it may not be that much help for enlightenment as such. So I will speak in English now.
So, dear brothers, sisters,
Chodo Pumul Hengye, La Shuyela, Mandalaya Terinde Zombre, Chushua,
Hong Kong, and perhaps some Taiwanese also. I think even some from mainland China, and then some other Buddhist countries, and also some non-Buddhist countries, I think such as Chile or South American, I think some people here. So firstly, I would like to express my greetings. It seems now, weather also now, greeting to you. Till yesterday, a lot of rains. Now today seems now the purpose of this sort of gathering is, you see, to achieve happy life, successful life. That's, I believe, that's the main purpose or main goal. The way, the proper way to achieve happy life, successful life, not only money, power, material facility, but ultimately much depend on our mental state. Obviously, material facilities provide us some kind of comfort or some kind of satisfaction, mainly sensory level. Some beautiful things give us some kind of satisfaction through seeing the eyes or the consciousness. Then through music we get some kind of satisfaction or some kind of a short moment, some kind of peace, tranquility from those sort of peaceful musics or something good musics. They're also completely relying on sensorial consciousness. Then food, taste, again physical consciousness, smell also like that, and touch also is like that. So some kind of satisfaction, some sort of happy feeling. From these sensorial way, it's very temporary. So long, beautiful music there, you feel happy. Then that music stop, no longer much. And then another sort of viewpoint or another sort of aspect we must think. The any sort of pleasant experience which come through sensorial level, no matter how sort of strong, but the case person who mentally very unhappy, too much worry, too much anxiety, that kind of sort of anxiety or suffering or painful experience in mental level cannot subdue by sensory level sort of pleasure. Clear? The other hand, the mental level, calm, the full of strength, self courage, self sort of confidence, and courageous sort of mental thinking. Then, sensory level, physical pain, okay, not serious. Even some cases, they, in order to get satisfaction on mental level, sometimes we deliberately carrying physical pain. So, through our own experience, it is quite clear. We want a happy life, but within the happy experience or satisfaction, two levels, sensory level, mental level. Between these two, mental level are more powerful, more important. So, I think another sort of reason, mental level, although they, as the sensorial level experience and mental level experience is common, we human being and other sort of mammals, dogs, cats, and some other sort of animals, and also the birds, even insect. I think same. Those sentient beings who have this physical, the physical level of experience and the mental level of experience, all have these two levels. That's clear. Now differences. We human being, we have this the potential of sort of knowing or thinking, imagination or vision. And also I think we have much sort of greater sort of ability to remember past sort of experience or past sort of histories like that. Then, so therefore, we, because more sort of intelligence here, see, more expectation, more sort of visions, ambitions, all these things, because of this intelligence. So this brings more distrust, jealousy, anger, suspicion. And this brings unnecessary fear. And that brings frustration, anger, like that. Clear? Even physically, very well. All the facilities are very good. I think you Singaporean, I think those, and the Hong Kong, those people also is quite materially very highly developed. So you, those people who have materially every facility there, and also I think almost every day some friend come and some nice meal and a smile. But that, if the person says some worry here about money, about power, like the about fame. Most of the worry, concern here in mental level, then your friends not easily see remove that pain here. And the money, of course, no ability. And fame also sometimes create more sort of anxiety, more sort of worry. So mere education, very smart brain, good education, also sometimes creates some more desire, more ambition. That brings more doubt, more fear. So education regarding brain development, that kind of education. Now today's modern education is actually materialistic sort of oriented education. In modern education field, not talking about moral ethics or warm-heartedness. So ultimate source of inner strength is warm-heartedness. It's quite clear. The reason warm-heartedness, another word, sense of concern of others' well-being, sense of respect others, right, sense of respect others. You see, when that kind of mental attitude there, no room to harm others, cheating others, exploit others, bully others, because you respect them. So, when you have to say no sort of negative feeling or negative attitude towards other, then there's nothing to hide. That brings inner self-confidence. With self-confidence, out of compassion, not some other sort of negative emotion, also sometimes bring, what's the self-confidence. That is something different. Ultimately, that kind of self-confidence based on ignorance, all negative emotion based on ignorance. So therefore, that kind of confidence is unrealistic confidence. With a confidence based on compassion, based on warm-heartedness, that confidence is sound basis. So with that kind of confidence, it brings self-confidence, inner strength. Through that way, all your activities conduct carried honestly, truthfully, transparently. That brings trust between, not only between human to human being, but also other animals. I think birds also, if you really show them genuine warm-heartedness, respect them, then even birds appreciate that. Mosquito, I don't know. number of occasion. One time in Oxford, say my talk, all the Oxford great sort of professors, you see, old dignified professors, you see, sit in the front, and I ask them, which sort of level of brain which have the ability to create sense of appreciation. So I mentioned animal like dogs or cats, these have that ability. If you treat them nicely, sincerely, they appreciate. So then I ask mosquito, according to my own experience, when my mood good, then sometimes I give blood, mosquito, provided no danger of malaria. Then I give blood. So looks, this I think he or she suck blood, then whole body become red, then fly. No sign of appreciation. So I asked out of my curiosity, those of the professors, see, no one answer. that question. So I think quite interesting. It's more investigate. So which size of the brain or which sort of level of brain have you see certain emotion, have the ability, can produce different sort of emotions? I don't know. I think worthwhile. So in any way, so the honest, transparent, compassionate sort of attitude truly bring trust. Trust brings friendship. We are social animal. Friendship is very important in our life. Money, sort of material sort of facilities, no ability to show us affection. Only living being. So in order to receive affection from other living being or sentient being, you must show them our affection, our compassionate feeling. Then, from their side also, then real chance. Show to us their affection. That's the basis of genuine friendship. So we are social animal. Therefore, no question. The one single person, no matter how powerful, but that single person alone cannot survive without other human, companions or human community. Because we are social animal. So each individual's sort of future depends on the rest of the community. So from the selfish viewpoint also, you take care more about the rest of your community, ultimately you get maximum benefit. That's a fact, isn't it? Huh? The more self-centered attitude out of sort of taking care, maximum care oneself, and always think oneself, extremely self-centered attitude. Through that way, you never bother about other sort of well-being, and whenever you have opportunity to exploit maximum way, then ultimately you will lose genuine friend. You will lose, the support or friendship from the rest of the community. And finally, you truly become lonely person. Even so long self-centered attitude here, mentally you are a lonely person. More compassionate sort of attitude, mentally you feel, oh, these are my friend. Look right side, oh, my friend. Left side, my friend. Like that. Self-centered attitude, extreme self-centered attitude, then suspicion. Look this side, suspect. Look this side, suspect. And you yourself remain a little bit distance from these people. Result, you get lonely feeling. Clear? So therefore, people who have not much interest about religion, it's okay. Remain non-believer. But the compassionate mind is concerned, or compassion, or love. These things should not neglect. Because this is, if we think properly, if we sort of experiment by yourself, you get the clear picture, showing more sort of concern of others' well-being. Ultimately, you get sort of inner peace, inner strength. Result, you get maximum, or your physical, then become more healthy body. Because healthy mind, healthy body is very close link. Now modern medical scientists begin to feel, in order to take care about physical health, there's no point to neglect about mental state. Some cases, they already carry some experiment. So therefore, practice of compassion, practice of sort of loving kindness, these things, irrespective whether believer or non-believer, every human being, so long as a social animal, so long want happy life, successful life, so long want more friends, less enemy, then you should pay more attention about this inner value, not only just money or power. Clear? So therefore, I always use a talk or sharing with sort of audience in order to achieve happy life. Please pay more attention about our inner values. So my number one commitment as a human being, on a human level, I always make more deeper awareness the inner values and look inward more. Of course, material facility we need. For that, modern education, different professional sort of knowledge, highly necessary. But it is not sufficient only that much. We must pay more attention about our inner values, which essentially this biological factor is that we have that seed already. Even very cruel person, that person, the young age under mother's care, I think these people also very much appreciate mother's affection, and they themselves also have the full ability to show affection to one's own mother. Not only we human beings, but also other animals, like dogs, cats. We can see their youngsters. Their life, their survival, entirely depend on others' care, particularly their mother's care. We human beings also like that. So we, everybody, our life started that way. So biologically, I think our life is to start and grow in the atmosphere of affection. That's like the reality. That's the, I think, the reality like that. So therefore, we all have the potential to develop this. Oh, I forget. Firstly, the recite. I forget. Sorry. Now, firstly, our main sort of main talk. The one important Buddhist text. So, at the beginning, it is very relevant. Recite usually when you see someone who can recite some Pali Sutra, then usually you see firstly recite Pali Sutra. Yomarvatri. So now today, the according arrangement, now the Heart Sutra, chanting Heart Sutra in Chinese language. So before that, I think tea more urgent. Otherwise, it will be cool. Wait. See, with bread, full mouth, you can't chant. So wherever I go, I always talk about these human level, human values. Then second level, then second my commitment, then I am talking on the level of I am Buddhist. So because not only in past history, even today, sometimes religious faith also become barrier people to people, sometimes causing problems. So that's very, very unfortunate. When we look the real essence of all major religious tradition, same like Christianity, Islam, different Hinduism, Judaism, and also Zoroastrian, all these Buddhism, Jainism, all major religious tradition, the essence practice or essence of the message of this religion is same, love, compassion. With that, forgiveness, tolerance, self-discipline. These are the basis of moral ethics. So all major religious traditions have same potential to bring moral ethics. So, of course, in the philosophical field, big differences, like Buddhism and Jainism, and also on ancient Hinduism, believe no God. No creator, but ourselves. So, believe law of causality, not creator. That's quite similar to that of Darwinian theory. Everything, evolution, that way. So Buddhists also same way of thinking. And then, all other religions, their fundamental sort of faith is Creator, God, Allah, So in philosophical field, big differences. But then, as far as sort of in philosophical field, different philosophical viewpoint is, even among Buddhists, among Buddhism, there are big differences, different sort of philosophical view. These major different philosophical view taught by Buddha himself. So, I usually use it explaining the contradictory philosophical view taught by Buddha himself. So this is certainly not out of Buddha's own confusion. No, fully enlightened person, no possible to get confusion. nor he deliberately tried to create more confusion among his disciple. No. His sort of, what's it, the through eons was a practice of compassion. Then finally enlightened. So such person, say, slightest sort of, what's it, slightest was a factor to create confusion on others' mind. So then why Buddha taught contradictory philosophy? The answer is, among his own disciples, there are different mental dispositions. Therefore, it is necessary, according their mental capacity, show different path, different method. So, from this sort of Buddha's own sort of picture, we can understand. Oh, there are religions which emphasis the creator, God as a creator. Certainly understandable to some people. That kind of way of approach is very, very suitable, very effective. Even among Buddhists, without knowing the whole sort of system properly, then we also sometimes, you see, consider Buddha as a creator, our own future in the hands of Buddha. So, so you also, you see, the Chinese Buddhists also, Amitabha. So almost consider that as a creator. Isn't it? Or Tibetan also, you see, the Avalokiteshvara almost consider creator. So my future entirely depend on his hand. That's almost like it's the same view as a create sort of view of the philosophical viewpoint of the, what's it, the creator, like that. So therefore, that sort of concept is very, very powerful. Obviously, the real troublemaker is too much self-centered attitude, as I mentioned earlier. So single-pointed faith towards God, immense help to reduce that. You, nothing but God's creation. You totally submit you yourself to God. So that single-pointed faith to God reduces arrogant, self-centered attitude. Isn't it? And then also God consider infinite love. So anyone who sincerely faith to that kind of sort of God, infinite love, and his teaching also, teaching of love, compassion. And according Muslim, Allah, infinite love. So therefore, the person who truly believe this creator, this God, if that person is very sincere, then automatically pay more attention about practice of love and compassion. So we already notice among the Christians, among Muslims also, among the Jews, you see, people who totally dedicated their life for well-being of others, serving to others. So such sort of the willpower come from their own faith. So once we knows these factors, this fact, and then we develop automatically, we develop respect, admiration, and feeling of gratitude, appreciation comes automatically. I myself, Buddhist, sometimes I describe I'm staunch Buddhist. That means I know all the faults of the, what's it, the theosophical field, I mean the philosophical field, the others different philosophical views, you see, Buddhist sort of view to, what's it, point out contradictions, like the Chitta Mantra philosophical viewpoint. There's a much sort of, what should they argue or debate or point out the contradictions from Madhyamika viewpoint. So more carefully study about Madhyamika philosophical viewpoint, then we will realize in Chitta Mantra's philosophical viewpoint, or if we really think very sort of deeply, you find contradictions. So then the non-theistic religious viewpoint, so we find contradictions according to the theistic religious sort of viewpoint. Of course, not out of disrespect, half joke, half a little bit sort of serious. I think two years ago, one my Indian friend, one Sadaji, wonderful person, a medical profession, wonderful. He really carry sort of, what's it, a compassionate work in the medical field. Really, wonderfully he sort of serving concerned people, really wonderful. So one after we know each other, one day he came to see me, and he seriously put a question to me. Oh, God creates the whole world. So among God's creation, there are so many mischievous people there. Why is God created that? Then I jokingly told him, since God created hell, so there must be someone who have to go there. Otherwise, no meaning creation of hell, isn't it? So these are contradictions, isn't it? From the Buddhist viewpoint. This is not out of disrespect. Of course, I very much appreciate Christianity, Islam, as well as all other. Sometimes when I sort of say pay a pilgrimage to church or some mosque, some synagogue like that, sometimes in front of Jesus Christ sort of statue, sometimes I really very much moving. This great teacher, as he brought immense benefit to millions of people last 2,000 years, and in present also, millions of people get immense inspiration from his teaching. So from the Buddhist viewpoint, not ordinary person, really, I think from Buddhist viewpoint, we can consider this great teacher as some kind of Bodhisattva or some kind of sort of manifestation of different Buddha. Very possible. Otherwise, just ordinary one human being cannot sort of, how should they, impact, bring impact or their teaching impact on such sort of number of people and long period. Like Marxist sort of ideology, Marxism, short period, not much. Although I myself Marxist. As far as socio-economy theory is concerned, I am Marxist, not Leninist. Since Lenin, I sometimes I feel the original sort of more compassionate nature of Marxist theory spoiled, I feel. The main reason is Marxism. You see, in Marxist economy theory, you see, mentioned equal distribution from money, isn't it? The capitalism, you Singaporean follow, you see, capitalism is a thing about profit. Not much talk about equal distribution, isn't it? So poorer section of people always remain poor, like United States, a great country, a champion of democracy, freedom, liberty, great country. I love America. However, within America, huge gap, rich and poor. These are unhealthy things. We have to, I often is telling people, we have to pay serious attention to reduce these sort of gap. Otherwise, this is not only morally wrong, but practically also source of problem, like that. So therefore, when I saw some of the drawbacks of capitalism, and I have more respect about Marxism. But at the same time, when I saw, you see, some of those sort of was the really the senseless sort of practice carried by so-called Marxist regime, these so-called Marxist, actually, I think not genuine Marxist. I think genuine Marxist should be realistic, should be scientific way of thinking, not just a dogma. So therefore, number two commitment is, since I study all these sort of Indian masters sort of philosophical debate about other sort of philosophy, so since I study these things, so therefore, I call myself as a staunch Buddhist. But yet, I genuinely respect all these major religious traditions. Wonderful. When I give some lecture, Buddhism in the West, traditionally non-Buddhist country, I never try propagate Buddhism in this area. I always telling them, it is better to keep your own traditional faith, traditional religion. Certainly you can learn some of the techniques, some of the sort of ideas from Buddhism according to your own single-pointed faith towards God. Then okay. I think at the time we make promotion, special effort for promotion of religious harmony, it is useful to know more about other religious traditions. It is helpful, isn't it? So, my faith towards Buddhism, but I respect all major religious traditions. That is very possible. So you, some Christian here, you practice continuously Christianity, at the same time respect Buddhism. And we Buddhists also practice according to one's own sort of the religion, but at the same time, sincerely respect, admire, to all other religions. So that eventually, I think the division due to faith can reduce. Of course, division is still there, but that causing some kind of negative feeling, that can eliminate. that's the basis of genuine harmony among the different traditions. Okay. So now third, now about Buddhism. So at the beginning, now chanting.
The appearance of the profound. At that time as well, Noble Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva, the great being, clearly beheld the practice of the profound perfection of wisdom itself and saw that even the five aggregates are empty of intrinsic existence. Thereupon, through the Buddha's inspiration, the Venerable Shariputra spoke to the Noble Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva, the great being, and said, how should any noble son or noble daughter who wishes to engage in the practice of the profound perfection of wisdom train? When this had been said, the Holy Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva, the great being, spoke to the Venerable Shariputra and said, Shariputra, any noble son or noble daughter who wishes to engage in practice of the perfection of wisdom should clearly see this way. They should see perfectly that even the five aggregates are empty of intrinsic existence. Form is emptiness. Emptiness is form. Emptiness is not other than form. Form is two. Form two is not other than emptiness. Likewise, feelings, perceptions, mental formations, consciousness are all empty. Therefore, Shariputra, all phenomena are emptiness. They are without defining characteristics. They are not born, they do not cease, they are not defiled, they are not undefiled, they are not efficient, and they are not complete. Therefore, Shariputra, in emptiness, there is no form, no feelings, no perception, no mental formations, and no consciousness. There is no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, and no mind. There is no form, no sound, no smell, no taste, no texture, no mental objects. There is no eye element, and so on up to no mind element, including up to no element of mental consciousness. There is no ignorance, there is no extinction of ignorance, and then so on up to no aging and death, and no extinction of aging and death. Likewise, there is no suffering, no origin, no cessation or path. There is no wisdom, no attainment, and even no non-attainment. Therefore, Shariputra, since Bodhisattvas have no attainments, they rely on the perfection of wisdom and abide in it. Having no obscuration in their minds, they have no fear. And by going utterly beyond error, they will reach the end of Nirvana. All the Buddhas who abide in the three times attained the full awakening of unexcelled perfect enlightenment by relying on this profound perfection of wisdom. Therefore, one should know that the mantra of the perfection of wisdom, the mantra of knowledge, great knowledge, the unexcelled mantra, the mantra equal to the unequaled, the mantra that quells this all suffering, is true because it is not deceptive. The mantra of the perfection of wisdom is proclaimed. That yatha gate gate para gate para samgate bodhi swaha. Shariputra, the Bodhisattva, the great being, should train in the perfection of wisdom like in this way. Thereupon the Blessed One arose from that meditative absorption and commended the Holy Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva, the great being, saying, this is excellent. Excellent, excellent, O noble child, it is just so. It should be just so. One must practice the profound perfection of wisdom just as you have revealed, for then even the Tathagatas will rejoice. As the Blessed One uttered these words, the Venerable Shariputra, the Holy Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva, the great being, along with the entire assembly, including the worlds of gods, humans, asuras, and gandharvas, all rejoiced and hailed what the Blessed One had said.
in order to carry Buddhist teaching properly, the both sides, from sort of as the person who explaining, that person's side also sincere motivation should develop and keep that motivation and then carry explanation or teaching. The listener side also should develop proper motivation so that teaching then create positive energy and virtues, accumulation virtues. So very, very, so then it becomes meaningful. So now I am, speak through Tibetan. Krishna, simple translation is there, Kadrata? Simple.
So please listen to English. Everyone ready? Okay. So, usually, with regard to having a correct motivation, we recite the verse of taking refuge and Bodhisattva, which goes like, I take refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, and I am enlightened, and so forth. And this particular verse, this one verse, shows both the principle of taking refuge and the practice of bodhicitta, the altruistic intention for awakening. In all the different religious traditions, they have the practice of submitting or praying to one's gods or the higher beings. But in Buddhism, those to whom we go for refuge are the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, as Chandrakirti has said. Those who aspire to liberation take refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. So the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha are the object of refuge for those who wish to reach enlightenment or liberation. So that is about taking refuge. So, with under the influence of this taking refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, then when you abstain from 10 non-virtuous actions and engage in virtuous practices, then these practices become Buddhist practice. So, without being under the impact of this practice of taking refuge, but if you may abstain from killing or stealing, or in other words, the seven non-virtuous actions, seven virtuous actions of body and speech, these are all done even by the practiced by Christians. So, with regard to wrong view, which is can be explained in the within the context of each religious traditions, like Christianity and so forth. So all the major traditions, religious traditions, have the practice of abstaining from 10 non-virtuous actions. So practice, doing certain practice, virtuous practice, within the context of, within the mindset of taking refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, becomes a Buddhist practice, whereas it becomes a Christian or Muslim, Islamic practice when they are done within the context of their way of submitting to the God. So in Christianity, they talk about the Trinity, Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. So when a person does practice of 10 virtuous actions within the practice of taking refuge in the three, the Trinity, that becomes Christian practice. So with regard to taking refuge within the Buddhist context, there are ways of taking refuge with the intention to become liberated just merely for oneself. And then there is a way of taking refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha by thinking about benefiting all the sentient beings rather than thinking of one's own liberations. So in the verse that we are going to, recite, what we are saying is, I take refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha until I'm enlightened. So what this shows is that you are taking refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha until you, with the aspiration to become enlightened, a Buddha, fully enlightened one. So with regard to enlightenment, of course, we have the enlightenment of the Shravakas, Pratyeka Buddhas, and in Mahayana enlightenment. So here, when we say, I take refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha until I'm enlightened, you are taking refuge within the context of the Mahayana practice. So when you do that, take refuge, and then abstain from taking taking life, then it becomes a cause for full enlightenment of Buddhahood. Whereas if you only wish to become enlightened for yourself alone, then abstaining from killing and so forth becomes a cause for that kind of enlightenment. And then with the practices of giving so thought that I've done may it become a cause for enlightenment to benefit all sentient beings. Choose that of bodhicitta. So all of us, as I have said earlier, we don't want suffering, but all of us want happiness. We are all same in this regard. But when we talk about bodhicitta, this intention, altruistic intention, we are not thinking only of benefiting oneself, but bringing benefit to the infinite number of sentient beings. So with this intention, you do your practices. So your mind becomes rather broad, expansive. You're not thinking only about yourself, your happiness alone, but you're thinking about, which is rather narrow, but you're thinking about all sentient beings who are infinite like the space. So, therefore, your attitude becomes very expansive, broad. So, for the benefit of, to elevate or overcome the suffering of all sentient beings and bring them to the highest happiness, cannot happen. You are not only praying for these to happen or just making a wish, but actually engaging in the practices of bodhisattvas, such as the six perfections, which are said to be practices for maturing oneself. But with regard to generosity, of course, when you give to others, you help others. And within this giving, you also, there's giving of life, saving life, and which is also saving others' life. And also there is the giving of love or affection, and so that also helps others. And then with the regard to practice of morality, the bodhisattva's practice of morality is based on refraining from selfish attitudes, selfish goals. Of course, there is the restraint from, you show restraints in immoral practices. And then there's the morality of how benefiting others. 11 types of morality. And then with sincere, warm heart towards others, then you abstain from engaging in immoral actions. And then there is the practice of patience, practice where you accept suffering, and then you deliberately take on suffering. And then this is a patience with regard to the reality of things. And then there's the practice of the perfection of joyous effort. And then the perfection of concentration. But here it is that of to generate or to cultivate the wisdom, which wisdom realizing emptiness, which acts as an antidote to both the obscuration or delusion, both our delusions as well as the imprints left by them. And then there is also the practice of what are known as the four ways of gathering or attracting disciples. So you have these practices. So not only remaining at praying for the well-being of others, but actually engaging in them through these practices. So the practices of generosity and so forth that I have done, may they become, so all these bodhisattva practices, whatever I have done, in order to lead all sentient beings who are infinite like the space to the ultimate enlightenment, may I may these practices become the cause for becoming enlightened for the benefit of all sentient beings. So this is like becoming an ascot. If you have to lead some person who doesn't know the way to his destination, first of all, you have to know the route yourself. Without knowing the route yourself, how can you actually lead other person to that destination? So in order to lead all sentient beings to enlightenment, to Buddhahood, you have to know the practices that leads to that, and then apply those practices within yourself and gain the experiences, and then finally reach that goal. And then help others follow that same path. So without having compassion, you cannot compassion seeing the suffering of sentient beings who are helpless. You cannot actually have the experience of bodhicitta and final enlightenment. So therefore, in order to reach that goal of enlightenment, you have to have the wish or the aspiration to Buddhahood, the bodhicitta, which is also complemented by that of the aspiration to help others, which is seeing the suffering and wanting them to the suffering beings to be out of suffering. So with regard to the term Buddhahood, or in the Tibetan Sangye, translated as enlightenment, Sang means to be liberated from all the faults, and then Geba means to have enlightened or awakened to all the knowledge. So therefore, enlightenment is qualified by the purity, the two purities. So in the Mahayana Uttara Tantra, it goes through, it touches or explains the seven Vajra points, which are Buddha, Dharma, Sangha, then the enlightenment and qualities, and then the enlightened activities. So chronologically speaking, historically speaking, first the Buddhas appear in the world, and then they give teachings, which is to say they turn the wheel of the Dharma, the transmissions. And based on these transmissions or the teachings, then the disciples gain experience and gain experience of the true path and the true cessation within themselves. And so the disciples following the teaching, so the Buddha comes first and then he gives teachings, and then with the help of these teachings, his disciples, whenever they, the moment they experience the true path and the true cessation within themselves, then they have the true experience of the Dharma in terms of the realization, and then at that point they become the true Sangha. Therefore, first, chronologically, Buddha comes first, and then the Dharma, and then the Dharma, and then the Sangha. But in terms of a practitioner's gaining the experience of the Dharma, first of all, you practice the Dharma and experience the true path and true cessation within themselves, by which you become a Sangha. A Sangha in the sense of a trainee on the path to enlightenment, and then finally you become a Sangha, a Buddha. So as soon as the true path you experience the true path within yourself, then you reach the first ground of Bodhisattva, and then pass through the path of meditation, and then finally become a Buddha, which is to say you become a reach a path of no more learning. So in terms of from this point of view, you can see the Buddhahood that you will reach in the end, is the resultant Buddhahood. Whereas the Buddha on whose teaching you rely becomes the historical Buddha, for example, becomes the causal Buddha for you. So you are taking refuge in the causal Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha in order to experience the same kind of experience that the Buddha has gone through and reached that final enlightenment. So once you develop this path of seeing, which is to say that you become you reach that of the true path, then this will help to overcome the delusions, the defilements within your mind stream. The reason why we say that is that there is the possibility of Buddhahood is because we have what is known as the natural liberation, which is that of the true nature of the mind, the final true nature of the mind. In other words, the clear light nature of the mind, which is at this point defiled. But then this Buddhahood is termed as light nature of the mind is termed as Buddha nature. So we have this Buddha nature because of this very fact that there is a possibility of overcoming all the defilements and reaching that of a Buddhahood. And therefore, sequence in which the Mahayana Uttara Tantra goes through the 7 points is Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, and then the enlightenment. So in order to reach Buddhahood, in order to attain the true path, the true Dharma within yourself, as well as to reach the state of true Sangha, and then become a true Buddha, you would say, I'm taking refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha in order to benefit others. So please say this prayer. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, Dharma, and Supreme Assembly. Through the collections of merit and wisdom created by giving and others, may I attain Buddhahood to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. Through the collections of merit and wisdom created by giving and others, may I attain Buddhahood to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. Through the collections of merit and wisdom created by giving and others, may I attain Buddhahood to benefit all sentient beings. So, according to the tradition of Kuno Lama Rinpoche, when Lama is giving some teaching, in the beginning, the Lama, as I do it usually, I say a praise, a verse of praise to the Buddha. Kuno Lama Rinpoche usually says a verse each day. So he seems to know a lot of different texts. So he would recite one new verse every day. But for me, to do that, I would have to look at some text. But I just usually say this praise of to the Buddha, written by Nagarjuna, which says I pay homage to the Buddha, the Gautama, who out of compassion has given teachings in order to dispel all the distorted views. So Buddhism, after becoming enlightened, the Buddha himself gave the four teachings on the Four Noble Truths. So perhaps the language that he used at that time and then later on his teachings were compiled into the Tripitakas, the three collections of the teachings, which are those of the Sutra Pitaka, which emphasizes on concentration. And then there's a Vinaya Pitaka, which is about Vinaya or discipline. And then the Abhidharma Pitaka for wisdom. So there is also the categorization of the teachings of the Buddha into what are known as the 12 branches of teachings, which may be subsumed into these three collections. So within amongst the 12 branches of teachings, there is one particular category which is known as the extensive teachings, which may be the teachings of Mahayana. And there seems to be other categories which are also about Mahayana teachings. But basically, the teachings of the Buddha in the beginning were compiled into the Tripitakas in Pali language, which are followed in Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma, Cambodia, and perhaps Laos. So these countries follow the Pali tradition of Buddhism, mainly. And with this as the basis, as the fundamental teachings, then, for example, in the Vinaya, we have the Vinaya, the code of discipline of monks and nuns, where the monastics have to know about what vows they have and how to keep the vows purely, and how to purify, or if they cause some infringement and so forth, are taught in the Vinaya, and then with regard to Sutra Pitaka, which shows or focuses on concentration, this also is there in the Pali tradition. And then, with regard to the wisdom, which is shown in Abhidharma, on the basis of the cultivation of wisdom, then the practice of what are known as the 37 factors leading to enlightenment are practiced in the Pali tradition. And then with regard within the Mahayana teaching, from the point of view of the Sandhi Nimochana Sutra, there is the teaching of the first turning of the wheel, and then the second turning of the wheel, and then the third turning of the wheel of the Dharma. So according to the Sandhi Nimochana Sutra, which is also known as the Sutra Unraveling the Thought, distinguishing the three turnings of the wheel. So according to this distinction, the first turning of the wheel, the Dharma, teaches that all phenomena have some self-defined characteristic, whereas the second turning of the wheel of the Dharma shows that these things do, and events do not have any self-characterized, there is no self-characterized phenomena as such. And so because there are certain disciples who cannot take this literally, then the second turning of the wheel literally, therefore the third turning of the wheel, according to the Sandhi Nimochana Sutra, is said to make the distinction between why the Buddha taught in this way. And so the Sandhi Nimochana Sutra, which is the Sutra of the third turning of the wheel, the Dharma, shows that of the Chittamatra philosophical view. So in according to which the school of thought, the dependent phenomena are self-characterized. And what is known as the perfect nature is the true nature of things. So whereas in the second turning of the wheel of the Dharma, it is said that nothing has any self-identity. It is according to the Chittamatran philosophy, it is not taken literally. And therefore they make distinction between why the Buddha taught in this way is because of refuting the fact that the view notion that imputed phenomena have some kind of characteristic, and this the imputed phenomena actually the dependent phenomena are devoid of such mentally constructed imputed phenomena, and therefore since these dependent origination dependent phenomena or dependent nature are empty of such a nature of imputed nature, therefore the emptiness is said to be that of the ultimate nature. So, on the using the four noble truths as the basis of the teaching, the Buddha himself gave elaborated on that. And of course, based on the teaching on the Four Noble Truths, there have been what are known as the 18 different sub-schools of Vaibhashikas, and these are explained clearly in Master Bhavavivekas Targujvala, or the Blades of Reasoning. And then there is also the Sotrantika philosophical school, which usually mainly focuses on reasoning when interpreting the teaching of the Buddha. And And then there's the Madhyamaka philosophical tradition, which says that there is nothing whatsoever which truly exists. And then within the third turning of the wheel of the Dharma, there is the sutra, which is called the Tathagata Garbha Sutra, which continues the teaching of the second turning of the wheel of the Dharma, where it says nothing exists truly. So in it, it is taught that the mind does not have any intrinsic nature, and the nature of the mind is such that the defilements are not in the intrinsic nature of the mind itself. And so the Tathagata Garbha Sutra teaches that of the Madhyamaka philosophy. Whereas the Shantideva Sutra and Langaravatara Sutra teaches that there is no external phenomena, nothing exists externally. In the Langaravatara Sutra, it seems to say that on the one hand, it rejects externality of things, but on the other hand, it seems to teach that mind has no true existence. But in any case, these sutras, which are followed by or used by the Chittamatra school, so here what I'm trying to say is that within the third turning of the wheel of the Dharma, there are two categories of sutras. One category of sutras shows the same kind of nature, ultimate nature of things, as it is taught in the second turning of the wheel, which are comprised in the Prajaparamita Sutras, the Perfection of Wisdom Sutras. And then there is another category of sutras which shows that of the Chittamatra view. And then within the Madhyamaka school of thought, there are two sub-schools. One which accepts that there is some kind of self-defined characteristic or phenomena, and other which does not assert such a thing. So those who... the first sub-school within the Madhyamaka, on the one hand, follows the same kind of theory as that of the Chittamatras, saying that there is no externality of things. And they also say that mind does not truly exist. But then, so in the Langaravatara Sutra, it says that there is no externality of things. So within this sub-school of philosophy, Madhyamaka philosophy, there is this, the Madhyamaka school, which follows the same kind of theory as the Chittamatra, while saying that mind does not truly exist. And so an example of such a master is Chandrakshita. So they are known as, this sub-school is known as the Yogacara Savatantrika Madhyamaka. Whereas Bhava Viveka and others do accept that there is externality of things. And they say that the external things as well as internal subjective minds both are empty of any true existence. And therefore, the way they explain or interpret things is in the trend of they follow after the Sotantikas. Therefore, they are known as Sotantika Savatantika Madhyamakas. So because Yogacara Savatantrikas, Yogacara Savatantrika Madhyamakas, they follow the same theory as that of Chittamatra, in the sense that they say there's no externality of things. And they are known as the higher sub-school of within the Savatantrika Madhyamaka, whereas the Sautantrika Savatantrika Madhyamaka, such as Madhyamakas such as Bhava Viveka, follow after the Sautantrika school philosophy, in the sense that they accept the externality of things. And then the subtlest form of Madhyamaka philosophy is that of the philosophical school, which says that there is nothing whatsoever which exists intrinsically or which has any self-defined characteristics, such as Chandrakirti and Aryadeva and so forth. So all the Mahayana all who followed the Mahayana tradition, such as Tibetans, Chinese, and so forth, we are all same in the sense that we recite this Heart Sutra. And then in Tibet, the Buddhism mainly spread since the in the 7th century, whereas mainly it was established in the 8th or 9th century when Chandrakshita was visited Tibet at the invitation of the Tibetan emperor at that time. And so he was a fully ordained monk, a bhikshu, and then he was also a great Madhyamaka master who wrote the Madhyamaka Alamkara, the ornament of the middle way. And he was a marvelous teacher, master. And then he was also a great logician who wrote the great text on logic and epistemology called Tattva Samgraha. So he taught the Tibetans the Madhyamaka philosophy and through reasoning and logic. And so there is this saying of the two lions of epistemology and Madhyamaka neck to neck, being neck to neck, or so because the Madhyamaka philosophy and the logic is using the logic he taught Madhyamaka philosophy, there this kind of saying evolved. In China, it seems there has not been so much study of logic and epistemology, and therefore study has not been done through logic and epistemology debate. But in Tibet, because Chandrakshita himself was a great logician, and he taught the Tibetans through logic, using logic and reasoning. And his disciple Kamala Shila also came to Tibet, and he was also a great Madhyamaka master, as well as, and he wrote the Madhyamaka Alamkara, Madhyamaka Aloka, I mean, the light of Madhyamaka, as well as an epistemology text on logic and epistemology, which is a commentary on the Tattva Samgraha written by Chandrakshita. And this commentary, Kamala Shila's Panjika, is also a very huge text, voluminous text in Tibetan. And then in order to dispel all the negative forces hindering the spread of the Dharma, Buddhism in Tibet, the Tibetan emperor also invited Guru Padmasambhava, who helped establish Buddhism successfully by overcoming the negative forces. And so in this way, Buddhism was established and spread in Tibet. But then after that, there has been some decline in the Dharma for quite some time. And around that time, when the Dharma was rather at its low ebb, the Tibetans were able to invite Guru Master Atisha, Divankara Shrijana. And then from the Sakya lineage, the Sakya Master, one of the Sakya Masters was able to invite bring the teaching of the Sakya tradition, or spread the Sakya tradition based on the teachings of Virvapa. And then the Gagyu tradition also spreads from beginning with that of Marpa Lotsawa, the great translator Marpa, who came to India and studied under many different great lamas, teachers of India, mainly Naropa and Maitrepa. With regard to Naropa, he was in the earlier part of his life, he was a monk and great scholar, and then in the latter part of his life, he became a great yogi who left the monastic life, who left the monastery and then became a highly realized siddha. So within the Mahasiddhas, there are those of the masters like who were still in robes even after becoming great yogis, and then there are those who left the monastic robe and assumed the yogis way of life. And then in the Nyingma tradition, which began with the masters Padmasambhava and Shandarakshita, and then there is the Kadamba tradition, beginning with that of Adisha, Dibankara, and then Sakya, Gagyu, and then the later, the Geluk tradition vault, which is also based on the older Kadamba tradition. And so these are the great Tibetan Buddhist traditions. And then from the Sakya, there are certain sub-schools which evolved, such as Jonang and so forth. And then Bumbo tradition was there and has been there in Tibet before Buddhism spread into Tibet. So let's now look at the text, Bodhisattva Charyavatara, or the Guide to the Bodhisattva Way of Life. So with regard to this text, it was written historically. The historians say that Shantideva, the author, lived in the 8th century. And two main texts by Shantideva that are translated into Tibetan are Bodhisattva Charyavatara and Shiksha Samuchaya. So Shiksha Samuchaya was written first. What is not clear in there, and what is not very written elaborately there is mentioned or written in the Bodhisattva Charyavatara and elaborated here. So there it would be good if these two texts could be taught together. So I received teaching on Shiksha Samuchaya from Kembu, the abbot Kunga Wangchuk, and then Bodhisattva Charyavatara, the teaching on this, I received from Kuno Lama Tenzin Gelsen. So both of these masters were from the Kham monastic institutions in Kham region of Tibet. Kembu Rinpoche Kunga Wangchuk was... So anyway... So His Holiness just read the title of the text. So with regard to the title of the text, which says Changchub Sembe Jobala Jukba, or entering or the guide to the Bodhisattva way of life. So Changchub here refers to Chang, meaning that of purification. And then Ge means to have knowledge. So the single Sanskrit term, Bodhi, is translated into the Tibetan with these two words. And so both the Tibetan the Tibetan words actually covers both the meaning of purification as well as enlightenment or awakening. So when the Tibetan translators started translating the Buddhist texts into Tibetan, they have where Tibetan words were there for the Sanskrit equivalent, Tibetan words were there, they used them, and where they had no equivalents before, they have coined words. And so in this way, they said that Tibetan language has been enriched. So of course in Chinese, there are translations of the Buddhist texts, but the terminology that you find there has become rather archaic, whereas the Tibetan still is a living tradition in terms of the Dharma. So the term Chang Chup in Tibetan Sempa means, so when you use Jangchup with Sempa, it means Bodhisattva. So with regard to the Pa, it could be the Pa, meaning that of a heroic or courageous and so forth. And so the, with regard to the Jepa or the way of life, so with regard to the way of life here, the practices that of the Bodhisattvas can be understood and to mean this, as well as the final enlightenment. So a person having trained himself or herself in developing that of the path, or which is to say bodhicitta within themselves, and having trained themselves, then once they develop this bodhicitta within themselves, they become a bodhisattva. And then having had this experience of bodhicitta within themselves, when they engage in the bodhisattva practices leading to that of the final enlightenment, they are said to be training or engaging in the bodhisattva practices. So the practices of bodhisattvas are, on the one hand, the way of life, as well as that of the final enlightenment also, as can be referred to as the way of life of Bodhisattva, in the sense of having reached the resultant goal. So because this text shows how to develop bodhicitta and how to engage in the bodhisattva practices, such as the six perfections, and then how to finally gain enlightenment, this text is given the title, The Entering the Bodhisattva Deeds, or Bodhisattva Way of Life. So the Indian texts usually have short titles like this. For example, certain texts, like the 400 verses, are named after the number of verses in the text. So it also is called a gyapa, or the 100 verses. And then Buddha Palita is named after the author himself. Then Madhyamaka Avatara, or entering the Madhyamaka, the middle way, by Chandrakirti, is named so that it shows that it is a supplement to the Nagarjuna's fundamental wisdom. It supplements that text in two ways, in terms of the extensive practices as well as the profound view. So when the explanation on certain texts are given in Tibet, the tradition is that it is explained through certain broad outlines of the text, whereas it may not be there in the Indian tradition. So the title of the text is Bodhisattva Charya Avatara, and the Tibetan translation is Chanjusambe Chebala Chupa, or Entering the Bodhisattva Deeds. And then next comes that of the translator's homage, which says, I pay homage to all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. And so when the text belongs to Vinaya Pitaka, the prostration or homage is made to the Buddha, the all-knowing one. And then the Abhidhamma texts are, I mean, in Abhidhamma texts, the homage is made to the youthful Manjushri. So respectfully, I prostrate myself to the Sugathas who are endowed with the Dharmakaya, as well as their noble children, and to all the worthy of veneration. So the Sugathas, as who are endowed with Dharmakaya, as well as his heirs. So Sugathas refers to the Buddhas, and the children, his children, refers to the Bodhisattvas, and the Dharmakaya refers to once you attain that of cessation, true cessation, you begin the process of purifying negativities through the path of seeing and so forth. And then as you progress higher and higher, you reach the point where you are totally free from, completely free from all the defilements. But that full enlightenment starts with the path of seeing. And therefore, we can use the analogy of the phases of the moon, beginning with the crescent moon. So we can say that the Bodhisattva on the first ground of Bodhisattvas, the first ground of Bodhisattvas have, in a way, attained that of the Dharmakaya to a certain extent. And then as they progress further and further, they reach the full moon of the Dharmakaya. Within the Dharmakaya, there is the wisdom Dharmakaya, and then there of the truth Dharmakaya. So this verse shows those of the three jewels in terms of the Mahayana three jewels of Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha. And then the text also says to all those who are worthy of veneration, referring to the ones lamas and abbots and precept masters and so forth. So what is the purpose of making this homage? Why is Shantideva making this homage is shown by the next lines. Here I shall explain how to engage in the vows of the Buddha's children. So the practices of Bodhisattvas, in other words, the three trainings of Bodhisattvas, the meaning of which I have condensed in accordance with the scriptures, it says. So what this shows is that the Shantideva is not making up something on his own, but what he's going to say teach here is not something that he himself has made up, but he's following the scriptures, what is taught in the scriptures. And then the question may be raised that if you are saying something which is already taught in the scripture, is it not a redundant repetition? He says no, because in the scriptures of the words of the Buddha, the practices of Bodhisattvas and so forth are taught very extensively, and also in the Asangas, the texts, they are explained very extensively. But here, Shantideva is saying the meaning of which I have condensed here. And so he's showing it rather, is teaching the practices rather briefly in a condensed manner. So a person who actually thinks, follows a text through with skepticism. So this is a way in which the beings or disciples with wisdom or who follow reason do that. They see what is the benefit of following the teaching, following the text, or studying the text. What are the ultimate goal? What is the ultimate goal, and what are the immediate goals or purposes? And so these have to be understood by relying on the words of the text. And so in order to reach the highest goal, the final goal of enlightenment, you have to first go through the temporary goals, and then that has to be relied on the words of the text, the content, and therefore the content is relates to you to that of the purpose, the immediate or the temporary purpose, and that in turn leads you to that final goal, and that is how these three are related one to the other. And so this is how a person with sharp intellect follows a text, whereas one with a dull intellect would just follow the scriptures. In that case, then, of course, they would have to follow whatever the Buddha has said. Literally, they would have to follow. And in that case, they would just confuse themselves, because Buddha says one thing in certain scriptures and others in other scriptures. Whereas if you know the purpose, the reason, and of the Buddha for giving so many diverse kind of teachings, then you would be able to resolve the conflict or the contradiction between the teachings. And then you can also take certain teachings to be interpretable, not taking them literally, but knowing the purpose and the reason why the Buddha taught in this way, and then other teachings as definitive ones. And therefore the Buddha has said, oh monks and wise ones, just as a gold is tested by heating, cutting and rubbing. Likewise, examine my teaching well and follow, and not but not out of your devotion to me. So just as the goldsmith tests the gold, the purity of the gold in these ways, through these methods, likewise the Buddha has said that you, whatever I have taught you, you have to check them. And through your experiment, reasoning, and in, your examination, when you find that you cannot, you can take certain the teachings to be literally, you can take certain teachings literally, you do that, whereas others where you which you find not acceptable literally, you can consider them as being interpretable or provisional teachings. And as Tsongkhapa has said, someone who accepts certain theses which is against reasoning, is cannot be considered as a rational person. And therefore, you have to know the content, the subject matter of the text, and then the immediate or the temporary purpose, and then the ultimate goal or purpose of the teaching. And also, Vasubandhu goes through five different points with regard to how to follow a teaching. You have to know first the purpose of the teaching, and then you also have to know, if you know the summary, the essence of the text, that would also have some significance to you. So by seeing the purpose, you would aspire to engage or study the text, and then one you would be able to, once you are able to summarize the content or the meaning of the text, then you'll be able to go into the teaching, engage in study of the teaching. Following the words, the meaning, and then there are the linking between the different parts, and then there's also the text, the part of the text which deal with the arguments back and forth. And so in other words, Buddhism has to be followed through reasoning, based on reasoning, and not taken for granted on just based on faith. You can't just take Buddhism or by reciting Amitabha. So we'll stop here.